On behalf of Matthew Hyde, the Bishop of New York, and all the Episcopalians in the Diocese of New York, we welcome you here today to the Cathedral. If you're with us in the room, or if you're with us online, we are just so happy that you're here to celebrate the Lord's Day with us. Everything that you need to celebrate the liturgy this morning is in the order of worship that you either were handed as you came in, or that you can download on the internet. And if we encourage you to sing along and to pray along, everything you need is there. After Eucharist today, the Congregation of St. Xavier, our resident congregation, as they do every Sunday, will put on a great reception for us, a coffee hour back there in the nave. We invite all of you to come and to spend time meeting us. We certainly want to meet you, especially if you're visiting us from someplace else. We want to get to know you. And if you're here from nearby, we hope to welcome you into our community. So welcome. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this? Or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you, and you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out." The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus stood among the disciples and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. And he said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" And they gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate it in their presence. And then he said to them, "These are the words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Then Jesus opened their minds to understand the scriptures. The two men were an odd pair. One was a small, dusty-looking Roman Catholic priest, and the other a flamboyant criminal, now reformed, working as a private detective. They had been asked to solve a strange case. A man had been murdered in his flat, which was on the upper floors of an apartment building. And no one, not the chestnut seller down the street, not the policeman walking his beat, not the doorman keeping watch in the foyer, not even the janitor cleaning the hallway just a few doors down, not one of them had seen anyone enter the apartment building or the flat itself that evening. Even more strange, there was no sign of the victim's body, just a streak of blood in the room. Father, the private detective, said to the priest as they made their investigation, "Upon my soul, I believe this is more in your department than mine. No friend or foe has entered this place, but the man is gone as if stolen by fairies. If that is not supernatural..." And then his voice trailed off. And another character cried out, "God, the invisible man." Both of our scripture readings this morning reveal that from the very beginning, the earliest Christians interpreted the ministry of Jesus through their sacred text, what the church calls the Old Testament, and the Jewish tradition, the Hebrew Bible. And disciples had to do this because during the lifetime of their teacher, they really didn't understand what Jesus was doing. In Mark's gospel, Jesus repeatedly tries to keep his status as the Messiah a secret. And even when Peter correctly says, "You are the Messiah," Peter misunderstands what this means. It's only by reading their scripture, you might say backwards, that the disciples truly understood. They interpreted the Old Testament with the ending already in mind, that ending being the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus. And so when they did this, they could see that, yes, Jesus was the Messiah, the Son of God, but Jesus was also the suffering servant. In Isaiah, Jesus was the sacrificial lamb in Leviticus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is the Adam in Genesis, but a new Adam who has wonderfully restored the dignity of human nature. Now, this way of reading backwards is similar to how a mystery novel actually works. When we read a mystery for the first time, we are told seemingly unrelated and unimportant details. The characters in the story are often confused about what is happening. We aren't sure how all these different details connect. And then in the final pages, we learn the truth. Sherlock Holmes, or Miss Marple, or in this case, Father Brown, reveals to us who actually committed the crime. And then once that mystery is solved, all those seemingly unrelated and unimportant details take on a new significance. The details fit together. Once the mystery is solved and we know the ending, this information throws new light on everything that has come before. We can no longer read the story the same way. Suppose one lady says to another in a country house, "Is anyone staying with you?" So begins Father Brown as he solves the mystery of the invisible man. Now, the lady does not say, "Yes, the butler, the parlor maid, the three footmen," and so on, though the parlor maid might be in the room with her or the butler standing behind her chair. She says, "No one is staying with me," meaning nobody of the sort you mean. But suppose a doctor comes and says, "Who is staying in this house?" as the doctor is trying to solve an epidemic. Then the lady will remember, yes, the butler and the parlor maid and these three footmen. All language is used like this, says Father Brown. You never get a question answered literally, even when you get it answered truly. And so when these four men, the chestnut seller, the policeman, the doorman, the janitor, when they said no one had gone into that apartment, they actually really didn't mean no one had gone into it. They meant no man whom they thought was the suspect. A man really did go into that house or the apartment and come out of it, but they never noticed him. And as Father Brown reveals, it was the postman. Because as he says, a postman is a kind of mentally invisible person. None of the characters noticed him entering because they weren't looking for a man like him. And none of them stopped to ask, what was that bulky package he was carrying in his mailbag as the postman left the room? Scripture tells us that human beings cannot see God on our own. In some ways, God is the invisible man or person. God has to graciously reveal God's self to us. Otherwise, the divine is beyond our comprehension. And that is why God's revelation in Jesus is so important. In Jesus, we can see who God really is. And what we discover is that the apex of God's power comes in absolute weakness. That God's true self is manifest when God becomes vulnerable to the vagaries of human life, including the worst of human violence. When God becomes familiar with and enters into our suffering. When God offers self-sacrificial love to the absolute limit on the cross. And that in this weakness and vulnerability is the ultimate glorification of God. God may be the so-called invisible man, but on the cross, God has been fully revealed. And this has a profound implication if the church wants to be witnesses to these things for the world. Jesus, like that postman in the mystery story, is not actually invisible. But for more and more people, he is mentally invisible. He has sort of faded into the background. We no longer know how to recognize him. People nowadays sometimes look for him in the wrong places. They think maybe he should be found where there is cultural and political power. But when we interpret the scriptures through the ministry of Jesus, we learn how to recognize God in our midst. We learn how to be witnesses to these things. And we discover that God is actually found in the margins, in those who are suffering. God is found in forgiving, especially our enemies and those who persecute us. God is found in acts of love that cost us something quite dear. And when we do this in this way, we reveal the mystery of God's identity. When we do this in this way for our desperate and hurting world, we make the invisible God visible.
We believe in one God.
Father, Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit and became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In this season of Easter, let us offer our prayers with all our heart, mind, and body, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. With Anglicans across the world, today we pray for the Anglican Church in Aotearoa, New Zealand, and Polynesia. With the Diocese of New York, we pray for Christ Church, Rye. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Gracious God, inspire all members of the Church, lay and ordained, to know your saving power and to serve you with true humility. We pray for the unity of the Church throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy. Give discerning hearts and minds to those who hold authority in the nations of the world, that they may move towards peace and away from violence. We pray for all countries torn apart by war, especially in Israel, Gaza, the West Bank, Iran, Ukraine, and Russia. Lord, in your mercy. Show us, your human family, how to share and mobilize resources so that those in need and those with plenty may join together for the common good. We pray for all those in our own city, country, and around the world who suffer from homelessness or poverty or who cannot find work. Lord, in your mercy. Break the bonds of illness, addiction, despair, and loneliness by your healing power. Deepen our faith, Lord, in your ability to bring us to full health. We pray especially for Leanne Thompson, Kristen Bergfeldt, Anil Bajja, and Delvin Wheaton, and others we name aloud or remember in the silence of our own hearts. Lord, in your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for the joy of resurrection and all the blessings of this life. We give thanks for all we name aloud or remember in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Receive all those who have died, that they may live eternally with you in the light and rise again in glory, especially for those whose earthly remains rest in our columbarium. For Edward Rodman Priest, for Nancy Zaros, for Gus Constantine Vasiliadis, and for others we name aloud or remember in the silence of our own hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Almighty God, you raised up Jesus Christ that the whole world may shine with your presence. Open the eyes of our faith, and so infuse us with the power of your Holy Spirit that we may bear witness to his name in all the cares and occupations of our lives. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give both thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise. At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will, they were created and
from the primal elements, you brought forth the human race, and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another. Again and again you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace. And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn.
Thank you.
so, Father, we who have been redeemed by him and made a new people by water and the Spirit now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, Lord God of our ancestors, God of Abraham and Sarah, Isaac and Rebekah, Jacob, Leah and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great High Priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit your Church gives honor, glory, and praise from generation to generation. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you in gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia. Alleluia.